So I'm going to talk to you guys tonight about being radiant and what does a radiant life even mean? I love how every speaker has just kind of piggybacked on one another. The messages have come forth. And so haven't y'all just been blessed by every speaker and the worship? I'm so thankful, and I'm thankful that you are here. So what does a radiant life even mean? You know, we hear the scripture about we are to be a light, like a city upon a hill. You know, we are the light of the world. And I think sometimes we hear these scriptures, but it's just like it's so cliche and so churchy. That is like, what does this actually really mean to truly live a radiant life? One of the definitions of being radiant is to be marked by or an expressive of love, confidence, or happiness. You know, Pastor Janet last night talked about the joy coming from the inside out. And she was talking about that you can tell if you have joy or if you don't have joy simply by your countenance. People can tell. And I remember being a youth pastor, I could just see it in the girls all the time. And I would badger them until they told me what was wrong with them. I'm fine. I'm like, look at me. No, I'm fine. I'm like, look at me. And so it's important for us to not just know all these messages and hear, but apply the words that we've heard all weekend to live out a radiant life. So, the title of my message is, are you fake and filtered, or are you for real? Yeah. Are you fake and filtered, or are you for real? Now, we have some pictures that I'm going to show. Now, some of you are not going to know what this is, and that's fine. That's why we have the illustrated sermon, so you can see. But there is an app called Snapchat. Now, I have one, but I never use it. I've used it like 4 times just to like play with it, to see. But you can get really creative. And what I have found with this Snapchat filter is that you can make yourself look all kind of crazy and creepy and scary. Nicole, my the other aunt to the nieces, she had them over one time, and she was like taking pictures of the girls. And one of them, I was sitting there, and she sent me this random picture of one of the twins. I don't know. It scared me. She looked like on Harry Potter, one of the like little elves, like those scary, like, and it's, I was like, oh my gosh, that's what it, like, Paul, my husband, could not even look at it because it creeped him out so bad. Anyway, so I just wanted you to see some of these filters through Snapchat. That's cute, right? That's Jordan. There's a little lamb, I guess, or bunny. I don't think it's the bunny. It's a bunny, okay. Hello! Like, seriously, that's just straight out creepy. There is Abby and Katie with the little filter on them, looking all sassy. And there is Katie and Abby again, just looking creepy. Who is that? Who is that? I don't know who those girls are. I can't tell because of the filter. There's Elena. So you can put like all these filters on you just by like swiping the button. Hello. Oh my gosh. Some of y'all be having nightmares of like Jordan's creepy faces coming out to get you. Cute. Elena kind of puckering out her lips some. I see that. Jordan, looking off in deep thought. What am I thinking about? Hello. You see how it just like enhances like all these things, like makeup and... Oh, come on. Hello. That's still Jordan. That's still Jordan. I'm not a slice. I'm the whole dang loaf. Just a little quote there. These are awesome, Jordan. Yes, I love these. See, I would just take these pictures like, hello. Oh, that was the face. Okay, stop right here. So this is one that you can take two faces and like swap your faces. So that's like her and I think her mom. Is that Dixie?
That's a YouTuber.
That's not you and your mom?
No, that's a YouTuber.
I'm so sorry, Jordan. I just straight up called you and your mom. That was like a face swap. Don't hate me, Jordan or Dixie. Okay, keep going. Aw, so cute. Any more? Awesome. No, thank you. Thank you for Jordan and for all the girls that gave me those. Yay for Snapchat. So these are just some things that we filter. And what I have found is you don't even have to have like a big degree to take pictures of yourself and make yourself look tiny. You know, you can give yourself like nose jobs just through like editing your finger on your phone. And then it's almost like when you are, I've never done this, but if you're like on an online dating thing and you put your picture and then you meet, the guy puts his picture and then you meet him, like you look nothing like your, and sometimes people actually put up fake pictures. True story. And then they'll like meet this person. It's like, wait, you look nothing like that person. Who are you? It doesn't even look like the same person. And so we have Snapchat, but even we have masks that we can put on. You know, like back in the day in the little McDonald's Happy Meals, you could like take your whole McDonald's. Andrew's like, yeah. You could take your whole McDonald's Happy Meal and like punch out all the holes and put this mask on. And you know, you have the photo booths that you can now put, which we still use those, you know, with the gluing of the stick to the different face masks. And I think makeup, I think fashion, I think Snapchat filters can be great, but I think a lot of times we're so focused, and Pastor Janet talked about that last night, so selfie focused that we're trying to portray an image that's really not true. And I know we can have fun with it, but I think a lot of women in the body of Christ are going so much to the extreme that they're not being real, that they're filtering their life through everything else but the Lord. And then they're wondering, why my life's a hot mess? Why can't I seem to get over this? It's because we're filtering our life through things that aren't true. So are you fake and filtered, or are you for real? Now, I have this light bulb over here. And when we talk about being radiant, you know, you can be radiant. There's the dimmer switch. This has still got some light turned on. And even if we would turn off all the lights and have this one light, you would still see it. And we're not called to be radiant in the church. And I feel like we all come together and we're all shining our lights together, which is, it's great. We're to come to church to get fed, to get filled with the word, full of the spirit. But we're to go out into our sphere of influence, into our places that we work, our families, our jobs, where it can be darker, and we are to be light. And what I'm seeing happening is too many Christians are wanting to play this game of, I will be light in church, but when I'm outside of church, I want to blend in with everybody else. And so we're having this issue of not being real, we're being fake, and we're filtering our life through the world instead of filtering our life through the word. And it is so important for us to understand the value of being radiant from within. There's now things on your phones that you can have this lighting to make your pictures look great. You can do so many things. It's ridiculous. Like, it's hilarious. I'm like, I don't even need a professional photographer. I can take it on my iPhone, you know? But talking about being radiant, and are we fake and filtered, or are we for real? So the Word of God says over in 2 Corinthians 3, 16 through 18, I'm reading out of the Amplified Bible, and it says, whenever a person turns in repentance to the Lord, the veil is stripped off and taken away. Verse 17, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Freedom from bondage. Verse 18 says, and all of us, as with unveiled face, because we continue to behold in the word of God, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, we're constantly being transfigured into his very own image, an ever-increasing splendor from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. See, a lot of us, we're wanting to filter and put this fake light on us that's not real. And we're trying to shine from the outside instead of shining from the inside out. And so being radiant, you might have gotten saved and man, your flame was burning so hot. And then life happened, and situations happened, and things, people, and your light just got dimmer and dimmer and dimmer. Before you know it, you're not shining at all anymore. And it's not about you shining for you. It's because when you are so turned on to the things of God, you can't get enough of his presence. You can't get enough of his word. And so as we go through this scripture, we're going to be, I want you to look at your own life and see, okay, am I really being a fake and filtered person, or am I being for real? So I want to tell a story. It's very embarrassing, but it's very true, and that's the only way I know to be. So years ago, I started, I'll just say this because we are live on Facebook, but I entered womanhood very young. That's all I'll say with the details because we have dudes in here. But I entered it very, very young. And so I had a lot of female problems, and I would always use that as an excuse, even though I had issues. I don't want to go to school. It's the female stuff. And sometimes it was true, but what I saw was I got out of things. Oh, I can play sick and not go to school. Score. So I would play up the female stuff. If my dad, because I got whipped so much because I was the queen of sass. I always got spankings. I always was sassy. I always got in trouble. And you would think spankings, you know, spankings did work for me to an extent. But me and my brother Taylor were kind of close in our spankings growing up. But I remember not wanting to go to school because the kids there were mean. And so I was like, I can throw the it's my time of month. But it really wasn't. I lied because I knew, because I had bad problems. Well, I'll just play this up to get out of going to school. So not only did I use that as my excuse, but then, Mom, I have a fever. Oh, my God, I have a fever. Or, are you okay, honey? What are your symptoms? I don't know, but I have a fever. I would eat something hot when she wasn't looking. And I'd put the thermometer under my, Mom, look, like it's a fever. Well, darling, are you, I mean, she was so, bless Mama's heart. Mamas want to believe the best of their kids, but we knew how to play them. And so I did that for several years. Well, what I did not realize was by me faking all of this sick stuff, guess what? When real things came that I wanted to do, I was really sick. And it was a hard lesson to learn that I realized I'm faking all of this stuff, not realizing one day when I really wanted to do something, I couldn't do it because I was dehydrated, I was sick, I had strep. And I think about that all those years ago was me faking all of this stuff by eating something hot, putting a thermometer. Oh, Mom, I can't. Dad, don't spank me. It's that time of month. Because when he spanked me, he really didn't beat me, but I felt like he beat me. And so I feel like a lot of us, we're faking our Christianity. It's not sincere. We look the part, but because we're faking it, we can only fake it for so long to the point when something really is going on in our life, we can't enjoy it and we can't partake of it because we sowed all of this being fake, portraying to be something else. And I feel like if we don't check that lifestyle, that filtered fake lifestyle, we are going to miss out on what God's calling us to do. So, going through this process of being radiant, there are three points that I wanted to hit on through this scripture. So, are you fake and filtered, or are you for real? We read in verse 16 of 2 Corinthians chapter 3, the first thing it says is that, but whenever a person turns in repentance to the Lord, not to repentance to people. I believe if we've hurt people, we ask for forgiveness. But when it comes to repenting, that is the first step, is that we turn into repentance to the Lord and the veil is stripped off and taken away. That veil is that thing, that filter that is separating you. I've done that before. When I would come into the presence of God and I was ashamed about something, I would come with all kind of filters on. Hello, it's not like he couldn't see straight through me anyway, but I felt better because I was filtering myself. So when I could come into his presence, I wouldn't enter in like I know I should because I've got all of these issues and I don't want to deal with them yet. Because y'all know, being in the presence of God can either like push you closer or it makes you very uncomfortable. Because he starts pointing his finger on these things in our lives that he wants us to deal with and get rid of. So having a repentant heart to the Lord. I remember growing up when I would get in trouble, because like I said, I got in trouble quite a lot for just being sassy and lying and all these things. And my mom would say, "Now, are you sorry because you got caught? Or are you really sorry? Like, you're repentant." Like, they made sure I knew what sorry meant and what repentance meant. Because sorry just meant, "I'm sorry, I'm going to do it again, but whatever." But when it was a true repentant, and it didn't matter how big it was or how small it was, "Now, are you really sorry for your, you know, what you did because you got caught? Or are you really true?" Because when you're truly repentant, you not only admit to it, but you turn and go the other direction. And so you walking out a radiant life is not impossible, but the first step is to be repentant. And when we talk about having a repentant heart, is his light shines on us where we are in our weakest state. He's not exposing these things to make us feel unworthy. It's like, "Hey, this is where you're weak. I can help you be strong in this." But you've got to repent and stop trying to rely on self and rely on Jesus. His light will dispel the darkness within us and around us. When Mandy talked about just sitting at the feet of Jesus, and she made this statement, and I loved it so much. She was like, "You do not have to deliver you. You just sit in his feet and he will deliver you." And so when you're in that presence, it's that same thing with that light and that glory. That darkness cannot stay in your life. That's why some people get in the presence of God and have this awesome time, but then it was awesome. I cried. This was wonderful. Then they go back out and they don't change. I want you to be changed from the inside out this weekend, so you can radiate a true glory, and that is the glory of the Lord. So there is, when the first step is being repentant. The second thing that we see in 2 Corinthians 3:17 says, "Now the Lord is spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty, freedom from bondage." Listen, it's not just enough to know that you're free. It's not enough to believe that you're free. It's not enough just to experience a day or a moment of freedom. You have to walk it out. One of my favorite communicators and women of God is Joyce Meyer. Her whole thing is every day enjoying your everyday life with Jesus. She's practical. Sometimes I would hear her and I'm like, you know, and she would teach because she gives you the practical things of how to live your life from the Word of God. And I feel like a lot of the body of Christ, we've just gotten so lazy because it's become cliche. Because if you're really radiant for the Lord, you're not going to take that stuff lightly anymore. It's like, no, it's time for me to get serious. So there is freedom. If we're truly free, we don't shine the brightest because we're dimming others' light. If we're truly free, you will never look at someone, "Well, I shine brighter than she does." Because a free person wouldn't talk like that. A free person would say, "I know what God did for me. Let me help you. Maybe you're not even shining at all, sister, but let me help you. Let's have Bible study. Let me help you. Let's go through the freedom keys. Let's go through a true image workbook." Just want to throw that in there. Let's learn who we are in Jesus together. If you see someone struggling, a free person's not going to be able to even this and even that. It's like, no. "Hey, I see that you're struggling. Let me come alongside and help you find what your true image is." We don't shine more by dimming the light of someone else. When we are in and living that free life, his light will illuminate that pain and brings the healing. Andrea talked about that this morning in their Ditch the Baggage, that the first freedom key was my favorite freedom key of all. God only reveals what he wants to heal. So when we're wanting that freedom, it's not just enough to, "Hey, here's a problem we need to fix." It's, "Hey, here it is, and this is how you do it." You sit with Jesus, you get out his word, and you say the things that God says over your life. And when you are in that presence, his light will illuminate that pain, that hurt, that wound, but he brings the healing. It's not to expose you, to make you feel uncomfortable. He's exposing you because he wants you healed and he wants you to be radiant. I know when it comes to radiation that people that have cancer go through radiation to kill the cancer cells. And I have taught from people that have gone through radiation how that's what they have to do to kill these cancer cells, but going through that radiation, because it's so powerful, it also can affect other things in your body. And the word of God and the presence of God and the glory of God is even more powerful than the radiation, but it doesn't do damage to other body parts. When you get in the radiant glory and the radiant presence of God, I don't know, can't remember, it might have been Pastor Janet last night, I think it was, just that moment can save you thousands of dollars from counseling. Thousands of dollars spent on medication. If you can just sit long enough to let the presence and power and glory of God burn all of that stuff out of you. We've been singing that about the burning ones. God, you're set me ablaze so I can burn for you. We're singing these songs, and it's these songs I just gave Ashley. It's like, hey, here's what the theme. And they have just, every song, every has just flown so beautifully to set you up to open your heart to say, okay, am I fake and filtered, or am I being real? His light will illuminate our pain and bring the healing. And when you get in the presence of God, that light, the radiating light of Jesus Christ, can do more in 5 minutes than any other counseling therapy could do in a lifetime. But you have to sit long enough. That's why I was so blown away last night that so many women stayed for so long. And I think, I really am almost positive that every single woman came up for prayer because they were wanting something. And as Pastor Janet taught, it wasn't just you wanted her, but she gave you something that was in her that was transmitted to your spirit, and you stayed literally for 3.5 hours. And you worshiped. I saw you. You're on your knees. You're letting God deal with those things. And I believe a lot of you are going to be so free that you're not going to know what to do with yourself. Second, the third thing, so there's repentance, there is freedom. And then the third thing that I wanted to end on is in verse 18. And it says, "And all of us, as with unveiled face, because we continue to behold in the word of God, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, and are constantly being transfigured into his very own image, in ever increasing splendor, and from one degree of glory to another. This comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit." It doesn't matter how loud and how flamboyant and how whatever you are, if that light is not coming from Jesus, that's wasted. That's wasted light. That's wasted energy. That's wasted passion. The Lord wants us to radiate from the inside out. So point three is to continue to behold. To behold what? To behold the word of God. When you see all those selfies and all those Snapchat filters, you're constantly checking yourself. I can't take a selfie. I've tried. I look ridiculous. I've tried to do the duck lips. I look dumb. I see people know how to like pose. I'm like, me and Amy try to take, I don't know how long it took us just to take a picture today. I was like, oh my God, Amy, no. Like I'm good if you're just taking like I'm good with this. Like I can, but Amy's like, let's do like a random funny, just like laughing pose. All of hers were so cute. I was like, why are you seeing all up my nose and like all these other things? And I just, we had to like filter through how many to see. I was like, okay, Amy, you can post that one, but don't even look at those. Like, delete all those rest of the pictures. But some, they just know how to pose. They know. It's so funny. And other people, I'm like, y'all do it so effortlessly. Whatever. But to continue to behold instead, and I feel like we're beholding too much of ourselves. We're beholding too much of the world. We're beholding things that don't matter and aren't going to make a difference in our life. But because it's here and it's now and we see it, that's what we gravitate to. So as we continue to behold, we're continuing to behold Jesus. We're continuing to behold just how you're looking at your selfie, or you're looking at your mirror as you're putting your makeup on, or you're checking yourself when you're in your car, just checking, making sure everything's okay. How many times do we look more at ourselves in a day than we do in the Word of God? Oh, we're beholding, but we're beholding self. We're beholding, but we're beholding others. And we're wondering why our life is not fulfilled. Bane, if y'all can come back up here. We're wondering why we're not happy. We're wondering why, God, where's my purpose? He's like, if you will get yourself focused off of you and onto me, you will find your purpose. We don't want to take the time to sit at the feet. We don't want to take the time to behold Jesus and his word. What you've experienced this weekend, you can experience every day of your life. Don't wait for conference once a year. Behold Jesus. We do this by staying in constant relationship with him. I can't behold my husband if I only see him once a week. Which this week it kind of feels like that because, you know, conference and it's crazy. But we stay in constant relationship with Jesus. We choose to allow the words of God to be our compass and the navigation to our life. Instead of asking, posting all these things, whether it's through social media or asking people, do you like me? Maybe whether you say that out loud or not, that's what you're asking, but you're wording it differently so you don't sound that crazy. I've done that before. When I'm insecure, like I would like work. Hey, I don't want to ask them if they like me because that'll be like creepy and psycho. So how can I reword this without making me look so stupid? But we are so concerned and so consumed with other people being our compass in life. We're so consumed, and I've been there a bazillion times of just trying to figure, God, what do you want? What do you have? I'm not going to get it by looking at the lives of other people. I'm not going to get it by feeling frustrated with myself, because I get that a lot. I find the navigation and compass and purpose for my life and my calling is when I just say, Lord, let me just spend some time in your word. Let me just get to know you, Jesus, closer today than I did yesterday. I think it's in Revelation where it says, you know, they forsook their first love. They just walked away from it. And we do church, we do Jesus like tradition. Spice it up, do something different. Staying in constant relationship, choosing to allow the words of God to be our compass. Did you see what this person said about me? Did you see what this girl said about me? They liked my picture. They didn't like my picture. They reposted my picture. They didn't repost my picture. This picture got a lot of likes. This picture didn't get that many, so I'll stick with this filter because this is what makes me more popular. And we're searching for all these filters. And the Lord is looking down on us. Will you just filter your life through me and be your own person and shine for me the way only you can shine for me? We shine so others can see Jesus, not us. I don't want people to see Lindsey. I want people to see Jesus. I was a hot mess. I didn't know my identity. I did, even though I came from a great family and I married into a great family. I can't get that security from that. I had to know who I was. And I think sometimes church people are the worst because you know, but you don't do. And so if we really want to be for real, we can't be fake and we can't allow ourselves to be filtered through anything else other than the Word of God. And I'm not saying all of this to bash social media, but that's to me, which is an easy way, is we filter everything. Let's slap this filter on because it blurs this. Let me edit my figure. Or I don't have hips, let me add some hips. we do all these enhances, and we might look stunning, but on the inside, it's fake. Because when you're truly radiating Jesus, the light's not man-made. You can't turn the switch off like that, because if you consistently behold Jesus, you're not going to worry. Yes, we'll have things to repent of, but I mean like the big stuff, like we're repenting of. But if we continue to behold Jesus, we will stay in a place of freedom because we're beholding Jesus. And as we continue to behold him, you might be here and you might just like your little light is just so, it's just barely there. But the more you behold him, that light and that radiant glory of God is going to shine brighter and brighter and brighter. But we have to start somewhere. But when it's true and it's genuine and it's sincere, it's the glory of God radiating from the inside out. People are going to be drawn to that. And people might not be drawn to you in the church because we all come and we get like this. This week, I mean, this isn't even bright enough for what you've experienced this weekend. But you go to your work, you go to your school, people say, girl, what's wrong with you? You're like, what are you talking about? Your countenance. I remember when I homeschooled and I went on my first missions trip and a girl met me in the football game and she's like, what happened to you? I was like, what are you? I was like, eighth grade. I was like, what are you talking about? She's like, you look different. Of course, I'm thinking, well, all of y'all, because all of the girls my age at that time, we were all dark brunettes. They were tanning, like Oompa Loompa tan, with bleach blonde hair. I'm like me, bleach blonde. No. But they all, I was like, well, man, of course, I'm thinking, well, yeah, because y'all all are blonde and orange, and I'm like dark hair and like pasty, so like I don't know, like I didn't know what she was referencing. But it said like you just like your face looks different. Well, I was like, yeah, okay, you're weird, whatever. Well, a few weeks later, I was praying one day and the Lord reminded me of that conversation. And it was that I went and encountered Jesus, that what the Lord was showing me, what that girl noticed was how different your countenance was. And so I believe that when you leave this conference, that you're going to be all, you're not going to look oopa loopa orange, but you're going to glow. There's going to be something about your countenance that's going to be changed because you have been immersed and saturated in the radiant glory, presence, and power of God. And so now what you have to decide to do is, okay, where am I going to go from here? I've repented. I'm walking in my freedom. I'm continuing to behold Jesus. And so being fake and filtered or for real, if you will repent and you walk in your freedom and you continue to pursue Jesus, you are going to shine, baby shine. And people are going to be drawn to you and say, hey, what's different about you? Hello, ministry opportunity. Girl, let me tell you about my weekend. Let me tell you, and I believe some of you are going to go back to your doctors and they're not going to find the disease that you had before. Some of you that have been on some things for your anxiety, the being in his presence just zapped you of all of that and you're not going to need that anymore. Why? Because I've seen that happen with other people. I've experienced things myself that it was beyond just me, you know, ooh, I love Jesus, all these great things, because I allowed myself to be real. And people can tell when you're real or not. People can tell if you're being fake. So why waste more life being fake and filtering your life through anything else other than the Word of God? Because we need women, we need moms, we need grannies, we need aunts, we need daughters, we need sisters and friends who are going to be truly radiant from the inside out. That you're going to show other people. It's not about how you look. Yes, we want to look nice. Yes, we want to present ourselves in a way that's pleasing and we feel good about ourselves, but not to where we are so selfie-focused and not Jesus-focused. So instead of looking and checking ourselves with the mirror, it's, God, let me put your word up in my face. Let me put your word over my heart and say, okay, reflect. Let that light reflect. Let the light reflect this. Let your light, your word, reflect my physical body if there's needing healing. So what I wanted to do tonight, I'm going to have the worship team come up, and we're going to end on a worship song. And what I wanted you to do is I want you right where you are. Get out a piece of paper, get out your phone, whatever you have, and I just want you in your own, whatever you need, to renew a commitment to the Lord this weekend. Maybe you're shining, but you're not shining like you know you need to be. The Lord will speak to you what you need to do. A renewed commitment to behold Jesus. A renewed commitment to not be fake or filtered, but to live a for real, radiant life. And let me say this. Don't you dare allow yourself to get in pride and not ask for accountability. If you really want to be for real, then you've got to submit yourself to those men and women that God's placed in your life to help you live the radiant life. We cannot be radiant by ourselves. Amy, I was talking with her like all weekend and just the encouragement and the thing. She's like, girl, you can do this. And we're just bouncing back and forth. And I exposed some things in my heart. She's like, well, I think that's something that you need to look at from a different perspective. It's like, oh. But then I was like, but you're right. I know. We have to be able to receive that. Because first off, if we can't receive it from the Lord, how are we going to be radiant? But then if it's a struggle, find somebody that can hold you accountable. Like, Chelsea, how's this going? Tamara, how's this going? Macy, Abby Shay, how's this going? How's your radiance coming along? Girl, it's a struggle. Well, tell me about it. I don't want to. Well, I'm not letting you leave until you tell me what's going on with you. I had a girl tell me earlier some things that she was struggling with several months ago. She's like, can I just be real with you? I was like, sure. There it came, word vomit. But she told me, she's like, I'm telling you this because I know you love me and I want to keep it real with you and you keep it real with me. I didn't kick her down. Oh my God, you idiot. Like, what were you thinking? You've loved Jesus all your life. How dare you do that? I didn't say any of that. She knew. I was like, okay, so what are you doing now? Helping each other become radiant. You're not going to worry about shining and dimming the light of anybody else.